Alright everyone, welcome back to Cody's Lab, and as promised, it's time to refine some silver. So this is some sterling silver, which I bought off eBay. There's a bowl, some spoons, a couple of plates, a napkin ring, and I'm going to be refining it down to fine silver, which basically means I'm going to remove the copper and other metals from the sterling. So let's see how much we have here. Looks like almost 450 grams of sterling silver. Now some of it's marked as high as 800, and others are marked as low as 400, so it'll be interesting to see how much I actually extract from this. Hopefully this will be a pretty representative sample of sterling silver. Alright, let's get refining it. Well, that was painful to do, because let's be honest, the silverware is probably worth more than the melt value of the silver. But the deed's done. May as well make the most of it and turn it into a nice pure silver bar. Now, the easiest way to process the silver would probably be to dissolve it in nitric acid. But on doing a little bit of math and figuring out how much acid I would actually need, something like 800 milliliters, I kind of got a lot of sticker shock and I decided that I would pursue a slightly different method. I'm still going to use nitric, but I'm going to supplement it with some sulfuric acid. Sulfuric acid alone will dissolve silver. It's just incredibly slow, and it really needs to be quite hot. So I put a little piece of silver into some sulfuric acid, and I heated it up to roughly 200 degrees Celsius, and I got it to dissolve a little bit, but then when I took it out, it actually re-precipitated some of the silver. You see that black material in there? It's actually metallic silver that has come back out of solution as it's reacting with the copper that was still in the sterling silver. It's really too slow. Now, like I said, I'm going to be using a little bit of nitric acid, and this is a mixture of sulfuric and nitric here. And as you can see, it completely dissolved it, and it actually did it quite quickly. Here's the reactions that are going on. So here's the reaction with the nitric acid forming silver nitrate and nitrogen monoxide. This is the reaction with sulfuric acid, which does not produce nitrogen dioxide, which is a bonus. And here's the combined reactions, and here's the combined reactions with all the extra stuff crossed out. So in this reaction, I only need 2 moles of nitric acid to dissolve 6 moles of silver, which is significantly less than, you know, the 8 to dissolve 6 moles. So basically what's happening here is the sulfuric acid is reacting with the silver nitrate to form nitric acid. I don't know if you can see. Yeah, right here. And that nitric acid then can then go back and redissolve some more silver. I think I'll definitely use that because sulfuric acid is far cheaper than nitric acid. I'm going to add about 500 milliliters of sulfuric and 200 milliliters of nitric to this. I think that'll get me pretty well on my way. And I'm also going to try to capture the gases coming off and recreate the nitric acid. There we go. As you can see, the acid is now in. That's kind of a lot of volume inside that container, but hopefully it'll be okay. You'll notice that the silver is not really dissolving. It is dissolving slowly, but it's not going to really dissolve very quickly until I actually dilute the acid with a little bit of water. By the way, if anyone thinks that I'm adding the acid to the water incorrectly, I will link into the description some of my older videos on the subject. It's reacting. And as you can see, I've got this thing set up. So it's also recovering the acid. So the nitrogen dioxide gas that bubbles out is going to combine with air to form nitrogen dioxide. Pretty sure I said monoxide the first time. Which then reacts with water to form nitric acid and more nitrogen monoxide, which can react with more air and more water to make more acid. At least that's the theory. No guarantees that this system will survive this run, but I may as well try. Okay guys, I might just be impatient, but this is acting like it's reacting very, very slowly. I'm sure I dissolved a lot of silver, but I'm afraid I may have saturated the solution. So tell you what, I'm going to take all of this out of here, all this fluid. I'm going to rinse the silver off with clean water, recover all that stuff that has dissolved, and then I'm going to finish it up with the pure nitric. Okay, so here's the silver. As you can see, I'm missing about 100 grams of it. Presumably the extra is right here in this silver sulfate, which is not dissolving, as you can tell. Also, there's quite a bit in this solution that is coming out now that it's cooling off. As you can see, I've cut the pieces into slightly smaller size. That way I can fit them down inside of that 2-liter bottle. Okay, here we go. Here's 200 milliliters of 50% water and 50% nitric acid. I'm gonna just add in increments of this amount until the silver's gone. Oh yes, this is gonna react nicely. This might actually react too fast. Yeah, I'm gonna get it in the cooling bath. Well guys, there it is. I've dissolved all of the remaining silver with nitric acid. Now as you can see, I've got over a liter of silver nitrate solution, which appears to have quite a bit of copper in there. I took about 500 more milliliters of nitric acid, which I sort of expected, which brings my total up to about 800 milliliters, which is what I had anticipated to begin with. So, oh well. I had to stop the time-lapse camera because it started raining. In fact, this air pump probably didn't fare too well. In fact, let's have a look at this and see how much acid we caught. That bubble stone has seen better days. Oh well. Let's pour it out on the concrete. It should fizz if it's got acid in it. Yeah, it's fizzing. Nice. It's not super strong, but it's an acid that I've recovered. Definitely a benefit to running the gases through water like this is I created very little fumes. You know, occasionally when I put in another shot of acid, it started fumes getting through, but other than that, there was hardly anything. Maybe build a more sophisticated apparatus sometime, yeah? Here we are, my silver nitrate and obviously copper solution. Some silver sulfate, which is not dissolving into water, and the silver sulfate along with sulfuric and nitric acid here. I guess it's time to extract the silver from them. All right, so I've got a bucket of warm water here, and I'm gonna dilute the silver nitrate in the bucket. The dilution will help make the silver more pure because the copper will remain in the water, and the more dilute I can make it, the less likely the copper is of falling out with the silver. Also, the large volume will help keep any lead in solution as well. All right, here goes. Now we got it diluted down in this big bucket of warm water. You can see that the there's a little bit of silver chloride actually forming because this was tap water here. And tap water, especially in this area, contains chlorine. Okay, so now this is a pot of salt water that I've made by dissolving some table salt into hot water. Let's pour this in. Look at that. Creamy white silver chloride forming as the sodium chloride replaces the silver, making sodium nitrate and silver chloride. Give this a stir. So you notice it's actually already starting to darken a little bit. That's because I've got direct sunlight on it, and the sunlight strips the chlorine from the silver, releasing chlorine gas and reducing it to silver metal, which in the finely divided state is dark in color. And actually, you can actually smell a little bit of chlorine forming, especially because it's hot and the chlorine doesn't dissolve into the water very well. Now that it's settled out a little bit, I'm gonna pour in a little bit more of this salt water to see if I got all of the silver. Now you can see there's a fresh cloud of silver chloride. I keep doing that until it's, that way we'll know we got all the silver dropped out. So I actually brought this bucket down out of the sunlight because the silver, as it was reacting to the sunlight, was actually beginning to float because of the chlorine gas produced. So now that I've taken it out of the sunlight, it's all settling down actually. And now that it's settled down and is clear, let's pour in a little bit more of this. Yeah, looks like there's no more silver chloride forming, so that means I've got it all converted. Actually, there we go. Nice curdles of silver chloride here. See that? It actually feels quite heavy. Otherwise, it'd be almost like cheese curds. All right, let's put them in there, let that settle out a little bit more. Now I need to get the silver out of this solution as well as out of the sulfate that's down here. So I'm gonna start by pouring off this solution, and hopefully all the sediments and all the stuff I was trying to get rid of will be down here or dissolved. And then I should be able to recover it from this using the chloride treatment again. You'll notice that the solution is turning blue. That's because the copper is now no longer in such an acidic environment. It's able to change its oxidation state, which changes the color because it's now got a different electron configuration. So I'm going to put the silver sulfate over into this jar here. Let's add some of this salty water here. Yeah, there you go. That'll drop the silver out. Now I decided that I'm going to actually put this into here because it's basically the same thing. And it'll save me time to settle everything out. My problem with gloves are they give you a false sense of security, and you play with chemicals you wouldn't otherwise put your hands into. And apparently these gloves weren't totally impervious to the silver nitrate. You can see my hands are all stained now. So I just got back from voting in the primaries.
So the line starts somewhere in the building. Comes way outside.
As you can see, this solution is now a pure blue color, and most, if not all, of the silver has settled down to the bottom here. I'm just going to pour off the solution as best I can. I've got quite a bit of silver in the bucket. Okay, so I've just squeezed the silver chloride through this cloth here, which has retained most of the silver and driven out as much of the water as I could. Now some of the silver chloride did go through the cloth and is now unfortunately back in the solution, but it should settle out over the next little while and I'll go through and recollect it. But I definitely have 90% of it right here. Now that I've got the copper washed out of the silver, I'm going to convert the silver into silver oxide using potassium hydroxide. The hydroxide will react with the silver chloride, forming potassium chloride and silver oxide. I'm just going to add in basically an excess. You see the black color forming as the silver oxide is formed. And the smoke coming up is just steam because this is producing a lot of heat. So it appears potassium hydroxide also changes silver sulfate into silver oxide. Now that these two are an identical substance, I can go ahead and add one to the other to combine them. So here it is, all of my silver. I guess you could call it black silver. There are some white bits in here. That is silver chloride that wasn't converted because it was in clumps or something. Fortunately, that is just a minority and it shouldn't hurt too much because silver chloride will decompose into silver upon heating as well. It just releases chlorine gas. In fact, the main purpose of converting it to silver oxide was to reduce the amount of chlorine gas produced. This lighter bit over here is the stuff that I recovered from the solution the second time round. As you can see, there's not very much of it, but it's certainly there. So now I'm going to put it inside of a crucible, cap it with sodium carbonate, and borax. Sodium carbonate, of course, is a base, which will actually help convert the rest of the silver chloride into silver oxide, and it'll also help as a flux to help everything liquid, and borax is, of course, to thin it out. And I'm also going to cap it with a piece of this rag here that I use to filter some stuff, because this contains silver as well, and this will be a source of carbon to help keep the silver reduced. I'll just kind of set this on top of the melt. They're ready for the furnace. So I know a lot of you are going to ask about what I do with my waste chemicals, and mainly what I've been doing is storing it for later reprocessing. In fact, I intend to extract the nitrates from this eventually, as well as any trace of silver that's still left. But for now, I'm going to destroy the acids that are there using some washing soda, which is sodium carbonate. Yeah, there was a little bit of sulfuric acid in there. Hopefully they don't boil over. Also, once I get this totally basic, copper carbonate should actually settle out of solution, so I'll recover the copper as well. It's probably about 100 grams of copper in there. And then once all the copper settles out, it'll be pretty easy to recover the nitrates. They'll make sodium nitrate. And certainly it wouldn't be something you'd want to eat, but you could certainly make gunpowder out of it. So I got me this metal dish. As you can see, I've burned it to get rid of any oils or anything. Let's take this out of the furnace, see what we got. Oh, did I just tip it over? No, we're good. We're good. It didn't come out. Molten silver here. Set this down and get a better grip on it. And pour it into the mold. Ah, that's perfect. There we go. Just about to harden. It's kind of got a lot of gas coming out of it there. Kind of annoying. I'm gonna have to deal with that. I'm all puffed up like a marshmallow. By the way, a lot of people have asked about how much power I use to do these projects. And here's the kilowatt meter. And I noticed that when I started this furnace today, this was at 47 on the end here. Now it's 54. So that's what, 4-7 kilowatt hours, which here in Logan at only about 9 cents a kilowatt hour, that's less than a dollar. Now that this has cooled down significantly, let's pop this out and see how it looks. There we go, came out easy enough. It's kind of off on the shape. It's like the metal deformed a little bit. I think the reason why it puffed up like a marshmallow the way it did was actually because of the flux I was using would have produced a little bit of carbon dioxide as it heated up, or possibly it had a little bit of water in it. And gases dissolve better in hot metals than they do in cold metals. So as it cooled off, it bubbled out just like a fizzy drink. So here it is, the bar of silver that I made. I beat it down a little bit. But still doesn't look perfect, but I say that's fine. Let's see how much it weighs. Unfortunately, it's a little bit too heavy to be weighed on my precision scale. So let's actually use this guy here. Should be within a gram, you know. All right, 340 grams, which means that I've lost 100 grams in weight, which I'm hoping is mostly copper. In fact, I was expecting to lose about that much due to the stamp marks on the silver, the original silver. And also I've got a piece of silver right here, which I actually spilt inside the furnace. And it was right around 3 grams, so not a whole lot. Was that 1% or so? I got over 10 ounces of silver. That's worth right around $175, I think, given the current spot market price. And I spent $220 on this, including shipping. So, you know, I lost, what, $50? Added in, of course, if you add in another $25 for the acid and supplies, I lost $70 to get $175. Oh well, I think it was totally worth it. A lot of fun. I learned a lot. I'm sure you guys learned a lot as well. Hope you enjoyed. I'll see you next time.